Hey guys, how's it going? I'm back at it once again with a brand new video for you, and welcome to episode 14 of our Gran Turismo 6 Let's Play. Before I start, I just want to say a massive thank you to everybody who watched the Ayrton Senna tribute video that I did for this game. Like I said, my video alone isn't going to do it justice, and to be honest, a lot of it was just me going wow and reading a lot of what was already on the screen, but I'm glad the people that did watch it appreciated it as much as I did. It's a very special video, and like I said, as much as I'm plagued for being born in 92 and not being able to fully appreciate Senna's legacy, because obviously it passed me by before I became a fan, you could tell and you can feel and you can see the impact that he'd left behind, and that's something that's truly special in terms of Formula One and what he's left behind. And it was a beautiful tribute by Polyphony, and they deserve praise for that. It's a shame it took them so long, and it's a shame it wasn't out with the game, but better late than never, right? I will be taking on the GC Academy soon, hopefully before the deadline, which I believe is June the... I think it's the 16th here. The 16th, so I'll try and get an episode of all of that in there soon. Also, like I said before in the last episode, the updated Goodwood will be out on the 26th. I will check that out soon as well. But, yeah. In case you didn't know, during the latest downtime, for the game, Mitsubishi revealed their Vision GT car, taking the count to four. And it is here. I'm not going to play the video again. It's, like, to be fair, this one's actually a fair bit shorter, but if you want to see it, the whole thing's already on YouTube, so check it out if you get a chance. It's a million credits, and it looks like a really funky rally car. As before, if you want to buy it straight up, it's a million credits. But once again, there is an easier way. What we've got to do is head over to the seasonal events. And as you can see, there is a super lap for the Mitsubishi Concept XR PHEV Evolution Vision Gran Turismo. The name totally rolls off the tongue. Also, before I start, I'm just going to sort out my controller configuration here. Okay, so brake with the left trigger. And I'm going to select. Yes, I'm going to use the accelerate for the right trigger. And then I'm going to make the nitro button X, I think. Where's the X? Also, nitro. Yeah, it's going to be as it is, actually. Yeah, that should be fine. So we'll see if that works out any better. I know it was AOR COS that suggested I do that. Hopefully it works out. Also, if my voice sounds a little bit down, it's because it's 2 in the morning over here in the UK, so naturally, I'm a little bit tired, even though I'm kind of a nocturnal person anyway. Anyone that follows me on Twitter knows this already. Anyway, here is the competition car. You get the car handed to you for the lap, as all you got to do is set a legal time around the Matterhorn, and you win the car. Which is awesome. I'm glad the game is so generous for a 1 million credit car or concept. What worries me is that these concepts have a tendency of handling badly, as you saw in the BMW Vision GT. BMW Vision GT video, I didn't like the torque that the car had. It was a bit like driving a mini version of Senna's race car, because driving that car with 1,000 horsepower and it weighs only 540 kilos, you're looking at nearly 2,000 brake horsepower per ton, which is friggin' ridiculous. Anywho, ARL Cos top of the leaderboard, no surprises there, 131.3. I don't think I'm going to get anywhere close to that. But like I said, all you've got to do is set a legal time and you get the car for free. There's some credits, obviously, for hitting the target times, of course, as well, up to 200,000 if you get gold. Because remember, the prizes stack. So hopefully, we'll get something half respectable. Again, keyword is I hope. I'm not the biggest fan of the Matterhorn track because it tends to be quite narrow, but it looks great. I mean, yeah, just driving around the Matterhorn. It feels like Gran Turismo took a page out of Forza's book with the Bernese Alps. You know, drive, have a track around the mountain and make sure it looks pretty. But, oh God. Be next lap invalidated. I'm nowhere near the start line. Alright, hang on. Bad car view. 1 minute. That might work. Okay. Feels right going up the hill. Not particularly fast, this thing. I'm guessing it has more than 6 gears. Ah, the track. Okay. Let's just try and get used to the car then, at least. Yikes. This thing's a little bit edgy. It's not bad, though. A little bit on the oversteery side. Whoa. I just don't have the confidence to go around that corner flat out in this car. And this demo section is always really tricky. It's narrow, it's blind. Often you're taking this at night, given how Gran Turismo works with this game. Often you're going around this track at night, and that's not pretty. Oh, God. I am not covering myself with glory on this run, if I'm honest. But I don't really care. I just want a free car. I must admit, I've not liked any of the Vision GT concepts that have come out so far. The original Mercs has been the best, and that still felt big and heavy to haul around. The BMW was too talky. And this one feels a bit too blocky to handle for my liking. Right, let's try this again. Almost lost the back end there as well. All these ghosts are just flying past me right now, I don't even care. It's like, guys, I know I'm slow. You don't need to remind me. Also, luckily, the Senna DLC added about 2 million credits to my account, so if there's a plus to all this. That was nice, actually. If there's a plus to this, it means I can actually buy more cars for this mode now, because I did promise I would try and use as many different cars as possible during this LP. And now I kind of have the flexibility to do that. Almost went wide there. God. This thing is really... Oh! Barrier collision. Yeah, this thing is really oversteery at low speeds. That's not a good thing. But it's not terrible. It's better than the BMW was. BMW was just way too talky for my liking, especially when under braking and under low speed corners. That's just me. None of the, like I said before, none of the GT series, the GT Vision cars have been particularly likable to me. I'm hoping some of the guys like Jordan and Nike and Lamborghini produce some interesting stuff. Oh god, another one? Really? Don't worry guys, I'll get there in a minute. In fact, it's probably quicker if I just do that. Because, you know, it'll take me about another minute and a half to get around again, so... But yeah, so you can see how easy it is to turn in hard and just lose the front end completely and just spin it around like that. It's not ideal. Also, this car having a turbo is so Mitsubishi, it's not even funny. I remember one of my favourite cars when I was a little bit younger was the Evo 8 when that came out, because it had a really nice looking front end. And I remember the Top Gear segment where they had it, where they had the 400 brake horsepower version. With the whopping great turbo on it, and it ruined the car nearly because of all the torque steer it had and the turbo lag, which was just nuts. But clearly 400 brake horsepower, all of that going through the front wheels of such a small engine as well. Nuts. I don't know what Mitsubishi was smoking trying that combination out, but apparently the 340 is a really nice car. My dad was thinking about getting one at one point. Chose an M3 instead. I didn't get the kids in properly. Didn't like the Legra a minute, but hey, what do I know? I'm not thinking about buying cars yet. I've not even got the driving license sorted out. Oh, that's off the track? Really? Ah, so strict. Okay. And we go around again. I was racing with my man Nathan Green there as well. Lap time wise, this is not particularly impressive. I think if I get one good run in, I could get the silver at 1:38, maybe. Oh, Jesus. Really? I went in too hard on that corner. We've been recording for nearly 15 minutes already, and I was not planning to spend this long on this car. This might be one for the editing booth. Make it look like I did it in two goes or something. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink. But yeah, this is arguably the best one I've had so far of the Vision GT cars, but that doesn't mean it's particularly good. It's a bit like what's the best way? It's a bit like winning the Europa League. You're the best of the B teams. You know what I think, if you get my drift? Because let's be honest, nobody takes the Europa League seriously unless you're the one that's actually won it. And if you don't win it, it's like, ah, it's only Europa, who cares? It's a bit like when the average Premier League club is in a cup, they pretend to care about it when they're in it, but when they get knocked out, it's like, I don't care. It's just a Capital One Cup, who cares? That kind of attitude. But yeah, watched qualifying this afternoon from Canada as well. It's Saturday night, or last Sunday morning as I record this. And no surprise really that Mercedes was 1 and 2. But everybody and their mother seemed to think that Hamilton was going to get pole, me included. And turns out Hamilton bottled it on his final qualifying lap for the second time this season. He did it in Bahrain as well, where he overcooked himself, and he did it again here. So yeah, Rosberg gets his 7th pole of his career. Great stuff to be able to start on pole for the Grand Prix, especially considering that track is a track that's As we can finally get the bronze there. A track that Hamilton's supposedly meant to be really good at. The weird thing is, by the time this video goes up, the race probably would have already happened. So I'm just going to go out and say that I think Hamilton will probably win still. 51,000 credits there. For bronze, takes over the 2 million mark. But, nice to see Sebastian Vettel in third. As you know, I'm the fan of his. He's my boy. And the Red Bulls and the Williams had literally nothing between them. I mean, there was about 2/1000ths between Vettel and Bottas for third and fourth. And, it was just finally nice of Vettel to have a decent qualifying session for once. His luck's been horrendous this season, and Daniel Ricciardo's out-qualified him 5-1. Don't get me wrong, a lot of that's down to the mechanical side of things, because working out, Vettel had an engine problem in Australia. Malaysia, he was faster because of the rain. China, Ricciardo was a bit quicker. In general, that whole weekend, really. Bahrain, Vettel had gearbox problems. Spain had the engine problem in Q3. And Monaco, again, ERS unit failure. So it's just been a really horrendous season for Vettel so far. And the luck's been really bad. And it's been a bit of a rough time as a fan, I guess. And I shouldn't really be complaining, considering that... that right now, at least, he's come in a 4 straight seasons of winning, so I feel like I'm a bit of a spoiled brat for complaining, but it's never nice seeing you guys struggle, and it's through no fault of their own, really. Anyway, in case you're wondering as well, I did actually get the Lotus 9017, and for those guys that didn't see it on my Twitter page, I did actually go back to the Brands Hatch Challenge and get a silver in it. I think I did a 1:09.8. Once you get used to the car, it's not quite so bad, but that thing has got so much torque. It's ridiculous. I want to see how much torque. I mean, is there a way of converting the torque unit over? Units, miles an hour. Display, maybe? Right, the size, no. Game data. Network. Not really, no. Race HUD. Yeah, it's just that, so... yeah, that's not really a thing. But I know it's a ridiculous amount, given it was a turbo in the 80s, basically. Okay, so let's go back to the A license real quick. Haven't been here for a little while, hey? So next up is the Gorner Grat League. And surprise, surprise, it's 3 races around the Matterhorn. The Rottenboden, the Riffelsee, I think that's how it's pronounced. Probably not, I probably butchered it, but who cares. And the Dristelen. A race event held in the Gorner Grat, an area commanding a breathtaking view of the Matterhorn, one of the world's most iconic mountains. Any car can enter as long as it meets the race requirements. How will you handle the steep corners of the intricate tracks that await? Okay, let's see what the game recommended for this. As I believe the PP limit is 600, and that's really it. Lotus Elise. That's not bad. Audi TT. Lancer Evo 10. I've had enough of Lancers. I've already done one. The 135 makes some sense because of the mission, the one make races we got a little bit later on. So yeah, let's sort that one out. Okay, BMW 135. 300 brake horsepower in this thing. Good lord. That's a bit much for a 1 series. Money, to be fair, the 1 series used to be a lot shorter and a heck of a lot uglier. It's not quite so bad now. Colour. Let's go for the dark one there. 64,000. Let's do it. I'm trying to kill 2 birds with 1 stone because I'm going to use it later on. But Yeah, BMW 135 from 2007. I feel old. That car does not feel like it's 7 years old now. It really doesn't. Again, maybe it's just me. Old ass Dre. Old man Dre kicking in again. I don't know. What's the new hot cars over here? Oh yeah, the Senna content, of course. Threading over the usual stuff. Like I said, the PP limit is 600. Like, that's hypercar performance in this game. A lot of racing cars, like Japanese touring cars and stuff, don't have 600 PP. But yeah, there's the Gorner Grat League. 3 laps of the Rottenboden. Should I upgrade this thing a little bit? Yeah, sports soft tires and stuff like that. We can upgrade it a fair bit. Certainly do the tires at least. Sports soft, yep. Body, take some of the weight off it maybe. 466, yeah, we'll do that. 470. Stage 3, 474. Bonnet, carbon fiber bonnet. We'll take some weight off the windows. Got some triple plate clutch. Carbon propeller shaft. Transmission. Nah, it doesn't really matter, but let's give it the 6-speed. And yeah, obviously racing brakes is quite nice as well. That's the basic stuff really comes to when it comes to tuning a car. Didn't even touch the power. Right, let's do it. Wait a minute. Evo X Rally car as a possible opponent. Because that makes sense. Right. Well, to be fair, they do have, like, 2 rally cars for the poster for this event, so maybe that does make some sense. Probably more than I realised. So we'll take down this league, and then I think we'll call it an episode. But man, I can't lie. Is it wrong if I'm frustrated about the Formula One season? I feel like I'm a bit of a hypocrite for complaining, considering that Red Bull were the team to beat for 4 straight seasons, pretty much. But it seems like the new regulations have, by accident, replaced one dominant team with a super dominant team. I mean, Red Bull has actually done well to close the gap a little bit. It was a second beforehand. It's now more like 7/10. I know Bahrain quality Daniel Ricciardo was the nearest man to the Mercedes, and he was 9/10 of a second back. Now Vettel was only 2/3 of a second back. So, you know, they have made some progress, and they have caught up a little bit. But Renault are seriously letting Red Bull down. Like, to the point where they're giving up at least, like, 10 miles an hour in a straight line. That's, like, a quarter of a second in the straights, at least. It's ridiculous, and you know, I don't think we're going to catch up this season. A lot of people have asked me on Ask FM and places like that, do you think Mercedes are going to win every race this season? And my response was, barring heavy, whoops, whoa, barring, ouch, giving quite the bump there, said barring heavy shenanigans, I think this season competitively is over for first. I think everybody else is now fighting for third in the drivers, and whoa, that was dumb. Let me just drive like this instead. It's probably a bit easier for my sanity. But yeah, as I was saying, is that just overall, I think everyone's fighting for third in the drivers and second in the constructors. I really do. I think Mercedes have dominated the season, and I think they will dominate the whole season. I think both Hamilton and Rosberg will have at least 300 points each. I think the team will have over 700 and break all of Red Bull's records in terms of constructors' achievement and whatnot. And I think the clean sweep is very much on. I really do. William Hill, the bookmakers, was offering 5-1 that Mercedes win every Grand Prix this season. It really wouldn't surprise me if they do. I've got a £10 riding on that right now. They might even be good enough for next season too, if they're 6-7 tenths a lap faster than everybody else. I think Monaco, a lot of people are asking me as well after Monaco, has Red Bull caught up? And I'm saying, well, if they have, it's not by very much. And I think Monaco, because of its nature, where it's the average speed is so low, it's a track where there's very little emphasis on engine power, that essentially it was flattering. And I think Adrian Newey said that in an interview as well, that, yeah, he said as well that the result he thought was very flattering towards the team, considering that Ricciardo was about 15 seconds behind the two Mercs until Hamilton got the dirt in the eye, which obviously allowed him to finish right behind Hamilton in the end. But Monaco is a track where you can't pass people, and even if it was, would we have the power to pass somebody? Would you have to be able to, we wouldn't have the top end speed, even with DRS, to pass the Mercs in a straight line. That says a lot about Renault right now. And like, I was watching Canada qualifying free practice, and in the straights, Mercs, Williams, Force India are hitting 335 clicks, which is just shy of 210 miles an hour. And on the other end, like, Renault are not even hitting 200, like 318 kilometers, which you can work out, we're giving up nearly 10 miles an hour on the straights. Unacceptable. Apparently Renault have got a major update planned for Austria in a couple of weeks' time. Hooray, Red Bull Ring back on the calendar. But I don't think it'll be enough to make 6 tenths of a difference. Finding that kind of speed in one season from top to bottom is near impossible. So, you know, it's, from a fan standpoint, we've been a little bit lucky that we've had two really good races so far this season. I mean, Bahrain was a 9 out of 10 on my scale, and Monaco was a 7. That wasn't just a good Monaco Grand Prix 2 weeks ago, that was just a good Grand Prix period, which is rare for Monaco, and rare in general. I mean, having two really good races in a season is rare, and that's a good thing. It's a blessing, especially considering that the season's been so dominant for Mercedes so far. But further back, it's actually still really close. Like I said, Red Bull, Williams, Ferrari, Force India, and McLaren are not that far apart from each other. I think Red Bull in the race are the second best team, but Ferrari, Williams, Force India, that's when it gets a little bit more murky. Especially given that I think Alonso is a huge boost to that Ferrari team. I think he adds about 3 tenths a lap to that car. I really do. And if anything, taking a step back from, you know, being the Vettel fanboy that I am to a degree, and, you know, sitting back and appreciating it a little bit more and watching from a more neutral standpoint, because given Vettel's season, there's not been a lot to be excited about, per se. And when you look back and see, and you appreciate it a little bit more, and you realise just how hard a task Alonso had or is going through right now, if that makes any sense, because it's like, ugh. It's a struggle for Ferrari right now, and even with the upgrade they brought along, they still look like they lack pace. Which is mind-boggling that a team of that size just doesn't develop that well. It's weird to me. But yeah, next race, the Riffelsee Matterhorn layout. I think there's like 3 or 4 different Matterhorn layouts in general. There's at least 3, not including those in reverse, but again, it feels very Bernese Alps to me, if that makes any sense, in terms of just having a made-up track in the middle of a really nice location and just, blah. It looks breathtaking. I mean, I've said it before, this game is like a showpiece for what the PS3 has done for gaming. And, like, this is just about the limit, graphically, that this past generation of consoles has gotten to. And it's gotten really annoying now that I think, because of the fanboyism nature of gaming, and how it's Xbox One versus PlayStation 4, all these guys arguing about, oh, which next-gen console's better, the answer is the PC. Whoa, bit of backspin there, whoa, not pretty. But yeah, saying that basically, watching these two guys try and play catch-up between Microsoft and Sony, and in terms of consoles, have you noticed how everyone seems to be talking more and more about what resolution these games are playing at now? It's gotta be at 1080p, and it's gotta run at 60 frames per second now, and I'm like, not really. Like, Need for Speed Rivals was the one that drew a lot of attention. I think it was from Total Biscuit when he reviewed the game. And he got really pissed when he basically stopped playing the game when he found out he couldn't change the frame rate. And the frame rate was locked at 30 frames per second. And I don't see what he was bitching about. I really don't. Like, I barely tell the difference in frame rate unless it drops below, like, 15. And, like, MotoGP's one was bad. Like, in MotoGP 13, there was times where the frame rate would skip and will go down, and it wouldn't be very nice. But the thing is like, I don't see what people keep bitching about. It's like, are you really going to tell the difference between a game at 900p and a game at 1080? Or a game that runs at 60 frames per second rather than a game at 30. I don't really care about that kind of shit. I want to play a decent video game. I don't want to hold a game back for being graphically bad, because a game is difficult for a game to be graphically bad in today's era. But when you ever watch a guy like Total Biscuit, who's a PC critic, a PC super critic, who's like the PC critic, the gaming critic in general, that's not from IGN or anything like that, who's just massively independent. And he always spends the first 5 minutes of every WTF is video talking about the frame rate options, talking about the visual options, like, oh, the resolution isn't good enough. And I'm like, really? Like, that's bad for you? I don't know. I think maybe we gamers have developed a sense of entitlement about these kind of things. Like, oh, it's got to run like this, this, and this. And I'm like, do it, really? I've never... For example, my brother's got a PlayStation 4 right now. I've got a PS3, so I've got a 360, and we both have Trials Fusion on there, and I could barely tell the difference graphically between the two. I sat back there watching them thinking, God, is this what people are bitching about so bad? Like, the fact that neither version of Trials Fusion is running at 1080p, or the Xbox One seems to be having the slightly lower frame, slightly lower resolution. Like, just make a goddamn decent game and I'm happy, right? You know. It's one of those things, I don't see why people are moaning so much about it. I'm moaning about moaning. It's really weird. And to be fair, maybe that's the Total Biscuit in me, to be honest, because he's the kind of guy that seems like a decent bloke, but also seems like a bit of a douche when it comes to game reviewing. But, you know, he has about 2 million subscribers. I have about 4,900. So, clearly people take his opinion a bit more seriously than mine. You know, independent game critic and all that. I'm not jealous or anything, promise. But, you know, that's the culture we live in when it comes to gaming now. Everything's like a matter of numbers now. Everything's got to be better than the last one. And, you know, I'm probably getting an Xbox One in August for my birthday, my 22nd birthday. God, I feel old. But I'm not particularly excited for it because I know there's not a lot of great games out for it at the moment, and you know, developers have yet to get the best out of their console yet. And apparently, now they've removed the Kinect, the games are going to start running better on there. You can get more performance out of it if you remove the Kinect, which kind of begs the question, why did they sell it with one in the first place? Like, I got frustrated when I found out that the Xbox One was going to be with a mandatory Kinect, which you apparently barely even use, and it adds like 70 quid to the price tag. It's proof of that now, because obviously now they're selling it without one for 350 quid, and it's like, well, what's the point? What was the point of going out there and making the Xbox One with Kinect a mandatory thing when people clearly didn't give a shit about the Kinect? Like, when it comes down to it, some of the best games the Wii has ever had were games that had limited use of motion control and, you know, the whole operating it with your body thing, which I thought was a nice gimmick, but I didn't think it would catch on. With the Wii, they found lightning in a bottle and it worked. With the Wii U, it clearly hasn't worked with the whole giant gamepad shit. But, you know, they tried it with the Kinect, didn't really work. People, like, mainstream gamers that were playing the 360s and the PS3 didn't really bother with it because it just felt like a gimmick. Just give me a controller. Like, that's what games have always been about. Why change the formula now just because we can? Sometimes, I mean, I remember watching this fantastic video from Game Theory about this, talking about, you know, how close are we to fully replicating a video game, and, you know, working out that we really aren't that far away at all. And also talking about, is that a good thing? Do you want that kind of immersion? Do you want to be exhausted from playing video games like an actual real life thing, like running around getting sweaty in a simulator, replicating a Call of Duty game, for instance? Is that really what you want? I'm perfectly okay with my controller and a copy of Halo 3, thanks, you know? Oh god, the Impreza drone around a long way, yikes. But yeah, I'm rambling on a little bit. I know it's 3 in the morning now over here, believe it or not. But, you know, I like to ramble a lot. I'm a very talkative person. Ask my parents, trust me. Whoa. That's the third time I've done goofed on these tracks, and I've been able to still recover. This one might be a bit difficult. This is by far the shortest version of this track, so it's basically a glorified oval. Look, I'm doing 110 miles an hour around the corner on the Matterhorn, and now I'm drafting this rally car. As you know, these rally cars aren't particularly fast in straight lines because they don't need to be, but what do I know? This is like the BMW Z8 challenge from earlier, which I friggin' hated. Just to see if I can close in the rest of the field in time. Got about a lap and a half to do it in. Gap's now 8 seconds, it was just under 11 before, so signs are looking good. That road is bumpy for braking, yikes. But the BMW 135 is great. Maybe it's the upgrades that are doing it more than the car itself, but it feels great to drive. It's got decent power. I mean, this has got 300 brake horsepower, and it feels about the same as the Mitsubishi I was driving a minute ago. And that's apparently got 500 brake horsepower. Certainly didn't drive like it had 500, I'll say that much. Got a slingshot around that corner, and I've got a nice draft. I was going uphill, and now downhill. Awesome. Right, but yeah, I mean, oh, I've been rambling way too much this episode, yikes. But, you know, apparently you guys like it when I talk interesting things. I really should do more episodes of Dre Talks now and again, but I just haven't had the right topic to really go at it. Nothing's really come up where I'm awful. I feel so strongly on this, I deserve to talk about it for about 15 minutes and see what happens. I guess the famous term, no news is good news, I suppose, right? That is a yawn. That is an audible yawn on camera. God, I need to go to bed soon. Bam. Finished. We just hit the 40-minute mark on the recording. Friggin' hell. Man, that's a bit too long for my liking. But the Gorn of Gratley, whatever it's called, has been dispatched. Excellent. Awesome. You're getting a lot more credit as well because I've got a 170% bonus now, which is pretty sweet. Like, it feels like forever since I've done one of these National A events now. And because we now have 20 stars, we've unlocked the One Make races for the BMW 1 Series, the Civic Sprint, and the Mazda Roadster MX-5, basically. So, next time, we will take on the One Make races and the Clubman Kart Cup 100, which I can tell you right now has arguably the most difficult race in the game, from what I've been told by many people. Can't wait. So yeah, until then, I've been Harrison101. Hope you guys enjoyed the video, and I'll catch you guys next time. Sayonara.